Hammond!
I have been rescued and I haven't even broken down.
Hello.
Scurry and so on. Well, this one, the Super Sport, did it in 1:16.8. Fastest car ever to go around our track. Now it's time to put a star in our reasonably priced car. We rang Cameron Diaz and we said, we said, would you mind awfully if, coming on the show? And she said, sure, love to. But only if I can bring Tom Cruise. So, ladies and gentlemen, here on this pokey motoring show on BBC Two, Cameron Diaz and Tom Cruise! How are you?
Throughout the show's entire run, this was the precise moment that Top Gear had not only conquered the British television landscape, but had conquered the world's television landscape as the biggest show on TV, bar none. No other programme was capable of pulling such star power as Tom Cruise and Cameron Diaz simply for the purpose of thrashing a cheap car around a disused airfield in the middle of the English countryside. This is the definitive point you can look back on and realise this was no longer BBC Two's pokey little motoring show, but was in fact a worldwide phenomenon. Later that same night, Top Gear would air their tribute to Ayrton Senna, a man who arguably meant as much to the world of racing as Top Gear did for factual programming. FOM's ridiculous copyright rules notwithstanding, the segment was an immediate hit and only served to help cement the programme's legacy as something that only came around once in a generation, with over 7.5 million people tuning in on the night of the 25th of July 2010. It marked the 56th consecutive time that Top Gear was the most watched programme on BBC Two during the whole week, a feat it would continue to repeat 108 times, with 6.65 million people tuning in via standard definition and a further 0.25 million on BBC HD. Another 2.5 million people would catch the reruns on BBC 2 and 3, and a further million on top of that would stream the episode on iPlayer in the immediate days which followed. Series 15, Episode 5 was also the 21st time that Top Gear was the most watched programme in its 8 p.m. Sunday time slot, where for years it had been at the mercy of the likes of Heartbeat, Big Brother, The Royal, and Strictly Come Dancing. In time, Top Gear would dethrone almost all of these programmes and would prove it was worth far more than merely the sum of its parts. Over on Final Gear, the episode received universal acclaim, averaging out at an almost unheard of 9.39 out of 10 from over 800 votes. It would become the highest rated episode of Top Gear in the website's history and would not be beaten until the finale of the Grand Tour aired 9 years later. Similarly, over on Pistonheads, the reviews were equally glowing, with many praising it as one of the best episodes of the show's run, or even the best episode, period. By now, the well-established trio of Jeremy Clarkson, Richard Hammond, and James May had become global icons, their faces shown to a third of a billion people. Top Gear had become, quite literally, the biggest show in the world. Most impressive of all, it had done this without sharing anything in common with any of its contemporary rivals. There was no gratuitous violence, no full frontal nudity. There were no gunfights. It wasn't a crime procedural. It wasn't a medical drama. And the only thing remotely sci-fi about it was the technology inside each of the supercars that were driven around the test track each week. And yet, it was the BBC's biggest hit. But how did it come to this? How could an unscripted television show, about cars no less, ever become such a runaway success for the BBC? How did its three hosts, with simple beliefs and a combined age of over 150 at the time of the show's cancellation, manage to attract such a large and varied audience? This is the story of Top Gear.
What is Top Gear?
It's a car programme, and it's a very big car programme, and it's three blokes talking about cars. It's very simple.
Top Gear would be created by Derek Smith as an inexpensive televised motoring magazine which could be produced at Pebble Mill Studios in Birmingham, where he'd worked for over 20 years. Top Gear would premiere on the 22nd of April 1977 as a regional exclusive programme in the Midlands. Presented by newsreaders Angela Rippon and Tom Coyne, the programme ran for a series of 9 episodes, where it became enough of a hit that it was greenlit to become nationwide programming the following year. In 1979, Rippon would be joined by Noel Edmonds as co-presenter, and given this man's track record, it didn't take long before Edmonds was causing trouble. 5 minutes, to be precise, in Edmonds' first ever appearance on the 1st of May 1979.
They might have put hours and hours of work into this car, but for me, it just doesn't happen. I've stared at this for ages, and bearing in mind that Fiat really have come up with some very attractive cars in the past, I just remain staggered that anybody in the late 70s, early 80s can come up with a design like this, because I think it is positively ugly. To me, it looks like a young child wearing very unfortunate national health specs.
As you might expect, Fiat were very unhappy over these statements and threatened to sue the BBC unless Edmonds apologised and rescinded his comments. But as far as I can find out, he never did. Rippon would leave Top Gear at the end of Series 2, leaving Edmonds to take on the role of main presenter, which he held for another year before setting his sights on bigger things. Judith Jackson, who had previously worked on Wheelbase, would take over as interim main presenter in 1981 for the show's 5th series before the BBC settled on Edmonds' long-term replacement, ex-Tomorrow's World presenter William Woolard. On Top Gear, Woolard was as erudite and as courteous as a lead presenter could get. Under his lead, Top Gear would become an informative and educational look into the world of cars, and his presence on the show was admired by many. Unfortunately, as peaceful as Woolard's yin was, he lacked the abrasive yang that Edmonds had previously brought to the table. Top Gear would begin to flounder in the ratings as the show mellowed out and cruised into the slow lane. As unlikely as it seemed, Top Gear needed an edge. In 1986, under the direction of new channel controller Alan Yentop, the show would be given an ultimatum and appoint Tom Ross, Ken Pollock, and John Bentley in the place of Phil Franklin and Brian Strachan, both of whom would leave the show that year. It was their job to reinvigorate the show for the coming decade. Bentley, who would later go on to work for Fifth Gear, made the decision to attend the unveiling of the Citroën AX in order to find a future Top Gear presenter. By chance, in the stands was none other than Jeremy Clarkson, and as fate would have it, the pair met and immediately hit it off. Despite only being a writer at this point with no on-screen credits to his name, Bentley was impressed by what he saw and had a presenting job on Top Gear waiting for Clarkson the minute one of the show's 4 existing main hosts decided to retire. 2 years later, Frank Page and Sue Baker would both step down from their role as main presenter, and Clarkson was in, debuting on the 27th of October 1988, Top Gear's 176th episode, where he covered a Rolls-Royce tuning firm named Hooper. Very early on, Clarkson gained a notoriety as an unfiltered motor mouth who pulled no punches, making his thoughts on topics such as diesel cars and the Morris Marina very known to those he encountered.
What on earth is this? It's a marina. Ah, I know what this is. It's a tail lamp of a Mark 1 Cortina, which I suppose were all the rage when this Salto jumble first started.
By 1990, he was already a household name, as this parody video titled Bottom Gear can attest.
Well, as you can see, an absolutely smashing car.
BBC's call would prove to be beneficial in the long run, and by the turn of the 1990s, Top Gear's audience had risen considerably from a few hundred thousand right through to 2 million tuning in each week. In late 1991, after a long and celebrated tenure, William Woolard would choose to step down from Top Gear, and the fresh-faced 31-year-old Clarkson was the obvious choice for his replacement. Some people become so successful at what they do that they receive kinghood in their respective medium. But few of those are able to have such an influential voice on their industry that they have an effect on it as a whole. Dubbed the Clarkson effect, this phenomenon became so pronounced to the point that a slump in sales in the UK car market for any manufacturer would more often than not be directly attributed to a denim-wearing, curly-permed tall man on the TV who said mean things about it, in contrast to the pre-existing Delia Smith effect, where good words could make cookware fly off the shelves regardless of its quality simply because it had her blessing.
But if you think that we on Top Gear have any bearing on how many cars are sold, have we got news for you. I seem to remember you raved about this particular car, the Renault A610. Now, would you care, Jeremy, to hazard a guess on exactly how many cars they sold?
704, 430.
They sold exactly 9.
Though it's debatable if Clarkson's effect on sales was merely psychological most of the time, when it mattered, his words hit harder than a hammer on a defenseless laptop.
God damn you!
This man wasn't just any ordinary motoring journalist who was trying to sell you a car. This was a man who was trying to get into your head. And it proved to be a saving grace in December 1994, when going against the advice of local law enforcement, Clarkson and his film crew decided to film in a particularly rough part of Detroit for the first series of Motorworld. Motorworld was a side project from Top Gear where Clarkson travelled from country to country, taking a look at various car cultures from around the world. And it's this series where the inspiration for a lot of the Top Gear specials originated from. Predictably, trouble ensued, and Clarkson would only be saved by a green-haired female accomplice of one of the assailants who just so happened to recognise his face from watching Top Gear. A year later, Clarkson would be tasked with reviewing the Vauxhall Vectra, and in this instance, it's what Clarkson didn't say that broke the Vectra harder than any harsh words ever could.
Bit of gossip for you here. The drummer in this band, right, is Danny Goffey, son of the very famous Chris Goffey. The car. Right, what else? That's dull.
I refused to road test the Vectra on Top Gear, arguing that if Vauxhall couldn't be bothered to make the car interesting in any way whatsoever, I couldn't be bothered to drive it. To understand just how dull this car was, you need to visualize a chartered accountant in a tweed jacket with elbow patches, playing cricket, in a period drama by Jane Austen, in Belgium, while reading out details of the Enron scandal, in a Birmingham accent.
When British production of Vauxhall automobiles ceased at the Luton plant in December of 2000, half a decade later, it was Clarkson who most of the fingers were pointed at. The same thing happened with MG 5 years after that, along with British Leyland as a whole. Even if the Clarkson effect was largely psychological, given how the Renault Alpine sold just a handful of units despite his praise, manufacturers and enthusiasts alike were taking note. By 1996, Top Gear had a whole crew of regular veteran presenters, including the likes of Steve Berry, Chris Goffey, Tony Mason and Michelle Newman. But make no mistake, Clarkson was the main attraction. Though it was never really publicised at the time, Clarkson began having internal conflicts with the BBC in the direction he wanted the show to go. As his influence grew, features on new cars became more abrasive and supercars appeared more frequently. But what he truly wanted was to be let loose on the world of cars. Unleashed, if you will.
I'll tell you what Pairful is. Bring on the punk. The Volvo. It's beyond Thunderdome. Every time you touch the throttle, it's like you're dancing with the devil. It's anarchy in the UK.
Meeting up with his personal director, Brian Klein, Clarkson would release the first of many home videos, the inaugural one titled Unleashed on Cars. And for the next 15 years, these would become a yearly Christmas tradition, with each home video largely following a formula of fast cars being driven to their limits around a fast track, typically the Kemble, Bruntingthorpe or Dunsfold airfields, and rubbish cars getting absolutely smashed into an unrecognisable pile of metal pulp. Again, you can see how the DNA for modern Top Gear evolved from these videos. Whether it's challenges such as the one lap magic from head to head between a road car, a rally car and an F1 car, the first and only officially sanctioned game of car skittles, or us Swift attempting to teach Clarkson how to parallel park his way with predictable results, the connection between his solo work and later work under Top Gear is undeniable. During the 2000 installment titled At Full Throttle, there was even a challenge between Jeremy and fellow Top Gear host Vicky Butler-Henderson to see who could build a more powerful street racer between a Rover SD1 and a Vauxhall Nova, with just £500 to spend on the cars themselves, Jeremy eventually winning after Vicky spun at the final corner. Yes! Back on Top Gear, Clarkson's continued presence eventually lifted the show to as many as 7 million viewers tuning in each week, figures that were unheard of a matter of years prior. He would also win the Royal Television Society's award for Best Presenter in 1998. Unfortunately, Clarkson grew weary of a programme he felt was too stale to continue in its current form and commenced his exit plan. Top Gear's 40th series finale, airing on the 17th of December 1998, concluded with a segment based on a dystopic future where petrol-powered vehicles were outlawed and each of the main hosts attempted to make a break for it, only to be blown up. Of course, it ended with each of the four revealing that they were alive and well, driving their choice of a high-powered sports car and wishing the viewers a happy Christmas. But in hindsight, this explosion was the character of Clarkson being killed off. On the 22nd of January 1999, he officially announced his retirement from Top Gear. With a massive power vacuum left by Clarkson's departure, the BBC scrambled to find as good a replacement as they could.
Back in the days when a new suit cost 2 and 6 and everything was made of real wood, Jaguar was very successful in this class.
The first of these was a little-known Bristolian by the name of James May, who had auditioned for the show back in 1992, coming off the back of his infamous firing from Autocar magazine, but was rejected at the time due to feeling too similar to Clarkson. The second was actor-slash-comedian Steve Coogan's brother, Brendan Coogan, who initially impressed the BBC but would be fired from the show not long after due to a DUI conviction in the summer of 1999. In addition to Coogan being dismissed, May would also soon be kicked off the show in favour of Kate Humble, a female presenter who was picked solely because she understood little about the world of cars. Though the show tried its best, it wasn't good enough, and viewing figures soon plummeted in Clarkson's absence. To make matters worse, at the end of every episode during this time, the first thing you'd see as the credits rolled was Clarkson's grinning face, almost mocking Top Gear during its darkest days. By the turn of the millennium, Top Gear was as good as dead, and without a big-name host like Clarkson, viewing figures sunk to an all-time low. For 9 straight weeks in early 2001, Top Gear would fail to place in BBC Two's top 30 programmes, with less than 2 million people tuning in at this point. Richard Porter, who had grown tired of lackluster premises for segments such as evaluating motorway food and looking at a person's collection of oil cans, quit his job to run a satirical motoring website by the name of Sniff Petrol, who Top Gear's showrunners would become fans of and would ironically result in his rehiring a little over a year later.
There's over 230 different cans here now.
And nobody else comes close on that one as far as you know.
Possibly within 100 cans.
However, just when Top Gear finally seemed to be down and out, in the summer of 2001, a miracle happened. Top Gear's viewing figures would double to over 3 million and for 7 of the following 9 weeks would place inside the top 3 programmes for BBC Two. Perhaps then and there, the BBC realised the show still had potential, but with more of a focus on high-octane action centred around cars that most people could not realistically afford. Increasingly, you'd see Tiff Nadell effortlessly power sliding around the track in a high-performance sports car, whilst female foil Vicky Butler Henderson thundered down country roads in a turbocharged hot hatchback. Other times, you'd see the dynamic duo perform stunts or run gauntlets, pointless tests that would not have made it to air in previous years. Along with third wheel Adrian Simpson, Top Gear began to change from less of a reportage style show and into more of one that Clarkson had envisioned a handful of years earlier. Though things seemed to be on the up and up for the first time in 3 years, it wasn't enough to stop the inevitable. On the 8th of August 2001, Top Gear got the axe. Barely a month later, former producer Richard Pearson announced that he and television presenter Quentin Wilson were working on a rival car programme for Channel 5, and the lure set by their old boss and colleague proved too tempting to resist, considering the alternative meant an uncertain future under the BBC. Tiff, Vicky and Adrian all hopped over, leaving just Jason Barlow, who was locked into a contract with the BBC for 2 more years. He'd briefly present Wrong Car, Right Car with Dominic Littlewood, before spending the rest of his career at Top Gear magazine, away from the television cameras. But in the midst of all this, something even bigger was brewing on the horizon. Not long after filming wrapped up for his forthcoming series, Jeremy Clarkson Meets the Neighbours, and as he put the finishing touches on his latest home video, Clarkson decided to rejoin Top Gear magazine as a full-time contributor in September 2001 for the magazine's November issue, and began talking to series producer and lifelong friend Andy Willman, who had seized control of Top Gear's television franchise that December. Over the course of the next few months, him and Clarkson would work together on the concept of a new car program that initially had nothing to do with Top Gear, but was intended to be a springboard into giving Clarkson a new regular TV gig. Its working title was Carmageddon, and the basic premise behind it is that it would be a scaled-down, weekly version of Clarkson's yearly home videos. To keep costs down, the series would be based at an airfield, and would feature a segment where supercars would try and set the fastest possible lap time around said airfield by a professional racing driver known only as the Gimp. Named after the character from Quentin Tarantino's Pulp Fiction, the Gimp would be a voiceless, faceless driver clad in black bondage gear to obscure his identity. Now, during this point in time, it was understood that both the revised Top Gear and Carmageddon would be two separate entities. They would likely have been similar in tone, both 30 minutes long and talking about cars, but that is where the similarities would have ended. Carmageddon would have focused on stunts, supercars, and racier, more risque content, whereas Top Gear would centre itself on road tests and news about the latest models, as it had always done. However, the BBC were likely not infused with the idea of bringing two new shows to air, both aimed at roughly the same audience, likely to be filmed at the same location, such as the Black Mountain Road in Wales, and almost certainly produced by the same people, many of whom worked on both Top Gear and Clarkson's standalone programmes during this period. In addition, the Top Gear name remained very profitable at this point, thanks to the magazine and other related merchandise, and the BBC were keen to keep the name operational with a presenter that they trusted. Eventually, even Clarkson came to his senses, and on the 22nd of March 2002, the BBC reported that he was coming back to Top Gear after a four-year absence. Immediately, he got to work, integrating the ideas he came up with for Carmageddon and firing Jason Barlow, the sole remnant of the old format. After vetting a variety of hosts, it was decided to settle on Richard Hammond, a young, enthusiastic presenter for Granada's Motor Week who had previously been turned down for Top Gear in 2000, and Jason Dore, a used car salesman from Cornwall. Dore was a last-minute addition after Clarkson's original choice, James May, declined, stating that he did not want to be on a programme that would end up becoming a failure, following three unsuccessful stints at presenting the car show, Driven, and the original format of Top Gear. In August 2002, the BBC would release its press pack for autumn of that year. Among the many new shows coming that season was a small piece on Top Gear, boasting of Clarkson's return. 1 month later, we got our first proper peek at the all-new Top Gear inside issue 110 of the magazine. This version of Top Gear promised to be unlike anything that had ever been seen before. Suddenly, Top Gear had a studio. It had its own racetrack designed by Lotus. It had a driver called the Stig who would drive around this track. And it had two new hosts eager to prove themselves. Interestingly, James May would also make an appearance inside this issue, though not as part of Top Gear's televised revival, which was imminently due to begin airing. Though this trailer admittedly didn't show much, one thing seemed to be clear. This was Clarkson's show, with the King of Cars back on his rightful throne. Hammond and Dore were simply along for the ride. Unfortunately, behind the scenes, things weren't as smooth. Production for the pilot episode of Top Gear was torture, resulting in two provisional pilots that were both ultimately deemed useless. Thankfully, everything seemed to fall into place with the third try at a pilot, and Top Gear finally got out of neutral and into first. On the night of the 20th of October 2002, a brand new era of British programming had begun. The first episode of new format Top Gear featured Clarkson praising the Citroën Berlingo Multispace, praise which saw the Mini MBV rapidly rise in sales, a track test of two of the fastest, most exotic Italian supercars money could buy, and the age-old question of how fast you need to go to fool a speed camera. All these were shown along with the star in a reasonably priced car, the talk show-style segment where Clarkson grilled a celebrity on all things cars before watching them take on the test track with it, with Jimiroquai frontman and classic car fanatic JK the eventual winner. The groundwork had been laid, and the BBC had set out its gauntlet to all comers. Ratings-wise, however, the first episode of Top Gear was a major disappointment, finishing 31st out of the 154 programmes to air on BBC Two that week, with just 2.43 million people tuning in. Public opinion on the episode was also mixed, with some criticising the appearance of supercars that most viewers wouldn't be able to realistically afford, along with the overall tone of the programme and some comparing the studio segments to Driven. Though there were a lot of viewers praising the new direction the show had taken, which immediately set it apart from Fifth Gear, Channel 5's relaunch of the earlier format, these critiques remained throughout the entire run of the first series, and it wasn't really until the end of Series 1 where the show began to hit some form of a stride, with the introduction of the Cool Wall, the transformation of a boring old Lada into a sports sedan engineered by Lotus, and Michael Gambon appearing in a reasonably priced car for the first time. However, on the whole, the British public were largely unmoved by the new series of Top Gear. It looked as though Clarkson's return and the revised format had bought the show some time, but the BBC were not satisfied. The overall recipe was good, but the ingredients needed some tweaking. They immediately axed Jason Dorr from the show and were hell-bent on getting rid of Hammond too. The BBC gave Clarkson and Willman an ultimatum. If they wanted to keep Hammond, they would have to find a trendy presenter to satisfy their quota. Perhaps more desperately this time, Clarkson reached out once again to James May, who had previously declined his request to appear on Top Gear after deliberately throwing his audition. This time, it worked, and the BBC were happy. Hammond got to keep his job, and Clarkson managed to finagle May into the studio at last. Otherwise, had things continued the way they did, it's likely the BBC would have executively meddled the show out of existence. Top Gear survived its first winter virtually by the skin of its teeth. But the world was changing fast, and Top Gear would be saved, not by the producers, not by the British public, but by an ever-growing number of eyes all over the world. Make that BBC World. The channel, which had grown out of the BBC's pre-existing radio-based world service in the early 1990s, took a particularly keen interest in Top Gear as one of the few programming mainstays on what was otherwise largely a news station for expats, sports tourists, and those learning English. And when Top Gear returned in 2002, they immediately got to work cutting up the episodes into half-length versions and making them more palatable for a worldwide audience. Though the channel was criticised for these edits, BBC World is how a lot of people my age saw Top Gear for the first time if they didn't live in the UK. But that was only half of the equation, and to explain why this is, we need to take a bit of a detour and look into the history of media distribution. The 10-year period from 1996 to 2006 saw a massive, unparalleled shift in media consumption and availability. Suddenly, there were new means to access media without the need for shed loads of storage or deep pockets, and 2002 was slap bang in the middle of this revolution. Personal computers were no longer for geeks, and people quickly learned that you could send and receive videos for free if you set up the right programs. As this was happening, internet forums were flourishing, especially ones centered around cars. People such as the aptly named Jabba of Jabba's World and Vuk of FastAutos.net then began uploading clips and even full episodes of Top Gear to their respective websites, and visitors, particularly Americans, were avidly watching them, to the point that the popularity these clips and episodes were attracting far dwarfed the rest of the websites in which they were hosted. One clip in particular, featuring the Koenigsegg CC8S from Series 2, became so popular it was impossible to avoid on video sharing FTPs, and the only reason I know this is because I found around 10 different copies of this clip in my search for old video files on long defunct websites through the Internet Archive. Eventually, the popularity of Top Gear clips on car forums drew so much traffic that it necessitated the creation of a whole new forum. And so, in 2003, quite possibly the most important website in the history of Top Gear was founded, Final Gear. Final Gear was the brainchild of Alex Mills, better known by his online alias Viper007Bond. The website, focusing on Top Gear and its immediate rival Fifth Gear, was an instant success, as it was essentially promoting the programme for free. Top Gear would return for its second outing in May of 2003, and the single most important change came over 20 minutes into the first episode, the announcement of James May as the show's third presenter. As Richard Porter explains in his autobiography and On That Bombshell, a terrific book if you haven't already read it, Series 2 more or less picked up where Series 1 left off the previous winter. Cars were tested, things were jumped over other things, and the team continued their hunt for Britain's fastest occupation, culminating in an absolutely bizarre collective of middle-aged cosplayers thrashing a Civic Type R around the test track. On the whole, Series 2 would unfortunately continue to falter in the ratings, drawing less viewers than its predecessor. The main problem with Top Gear during its first three series is that it didn't quite know what it wanted to be yet. One episode might show a riot van crashing through a house, and the next would feature a boring, leisurely group comparison test of several hatchbacks. Depending on how serious and factual the episode's content was, ratings would fluctuate between decent and anemic. What the show needed was a big ratings draw, something that set Top Gear completely apart from its rivals. After seeing news footage of war-torn desert nations fighting wars over exclusively Toyota-badged vehicles, along with an Australian adage that asserted the mechanical superiority of Toyotas against their British counterparts, Top Gear's first true lightbulb moment occurred. Purchasing a Hilux which had been used as farm transport for the first 15 years of its life, Clarkson then set about beating the hell out of it, smashing it through a shed, dropping a caravan onto its roof, setting it on fire, and attempting to drown it in the River Severn, where it nearly disappeared for good. A week after the episode aired, James May would get it placed at the very top of Rachel Point Tower in Hackney, London, to see if it could survive the tower's demolition. Over 5.5 million people tuned in to find out whether or not the Toyota Hilux would survive its seemingly impossible odds, and to the disbelief of those 5 million people, it limped into the studio for a cloud of its own smoke, battered, burnt, and bruised, but not beaten. The two episodes immediately left their impression on not only the British public, but around the world. Within a year of the episode's airing, Toyota would recapture the one-ton pickup truck market in the UK, in addition to launching a new trim level called the Invincible, boasting of the truck's seeming indestructibility. Toyota of America would use clips from the challenge itself to advertise the Tacoma, the larger local equivalent of the Hilux.
Just how tough is a Toyota? Some automotive experts in Europe took this 13-year-old pickup and tried to kill it. But the Toyota truck would not die. With that kind of bloodline, it's no wonder this Toyota Tacoma has a bulletproof reputation for reliability.
After this, the show's course was set. Over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, Top Gear would gain a strong cult following in both its native UK and the world at large. Viewing figures would permanently rise from an average of 3.5 million people for the first 3 series to comfortably in the realm of 4 million for the next 4. In general, the show started to push its boundaries outwards compared to the first couple of seasons. During its first year on the air, you wouldn't have seen Clarkson taking a Land Rover to the top of Croc and Rachkitten in Scotland, or a 747 engine tearing into a pair of old junkers under the thinly veiled guise of being educational. Top Gear's fourth outing would premiere in the late spring of 2004, and with it came two of the most important films in the show's history: The Race to Nice, which pitted Jeremy Clarkson in an Aston Martin DB9 against his two co-presenters in the high-speed TGV locomotive, and the 100-pound car challenge, where the trio were tasked with buying a working, reliable car for just £100. Clarkson would win the latter after just paying £1 for his then 15-year-old Volvo. Both of these segments had stemmed from Richard Porter's desire to film joint VTs between the trio, and although the three had starred together a handful of times in the past, it was Series 4 where this became a mainstay. Over the course of the next few series, Porter, Willman, and the rest of the production team would take these two ideas and continually up the ante, and most of their efforts would turn out to be among fans' most fondly remembered moments. With the show now a veritable rating success in its native UK, it was time for Top Gear to make its moves abroad. The first country Top Gear would set its sights on would be the Netherlands, with freshly launched lifestyle channel Veronica the recipient. Premiering on the channel in September 2003, the same month as its launch, Top Gear was an immediate resounding success and quickly became the biggest television show in the country, despite not being of Dutch origin. With this unprecedented taste of success in Europe, other television networks across the continent began to step forward. Poland would almost immediately follow the Netherlands' lead and secure Top Gear on TVN Turbo less than a few months later, where it too became its most popular show to the point they would make their own shady off-brand rip-off named Testosterone. Starting from September 2004, Top Gear would gain an unlikely audience in Russia thanks to NTV obtaining the local broadcasting rights around the same time the magazine was first localised there. Both the magazine and the programme became massive hits in Russia to the point that they would become one of the first countries to adapt the format into a localised version. On the 9th of November 2004, BBC would launch Top Gear on BBC Prime, an international station which serviced much of Eurasia. In 2005, Top Gear would continue to be picked up by more and more networks. October would see the programme's debut on BBC Canada, and not long after that, SBS over in Australia would also pick up the show, where it too became a runaway success, the channel launching its own local adaptation of the format a couple of years later. There was one country above all else that Top Gear wanted to make its mark in: the United States. Many networks showed an interest in picking up the programme, but it was Discovery who ultimately won out. Unfortunately, Top Gear's first stab at the American market would be a resounding failure, as instead of airing the episodes normally as other countries had done, Discovery would instead make the decision to form a compilation series which featured segments from the first five series, alongside recording new studio scenes in 4x3. The series received little promotion, and although Discovery had initially announced there would be a follow-up season, it would end up being cancelled due to low interest, alongside an American adaptation of the series with a similarly ill fate. On top of this, Clarkson's health had started to deteriorate, and he was diagnosed with osteoarthritis in late 2004. Though it was never officially stated, one wonders if part of Clarkson's decision to retire back in 1999 was due to this, and some speculated that he would be forced to retire not long after Series 5 finished airing that December. Midway through 2005, Clarkson would slip his discs while attempting to drift the Vauxhall Monaro VXR around the track, and this would put him out of action for a while. As grim as it sounds, this couldn't have come at a better time, as Top Gear was in the middle of a grueling 11-episode run which fans felt had run out of steam, particularly after the 8th episode where a group of sports convertibles were tested in Iceland. Unable to drive, Series 7 would be half the length of its predecessor and have a lot of the slack taken up by Hammond and May. This becomes especially apparent when you compare the presenter ratio of the 10 Top Gear episodes filmed prior to Clarkson's injury against the 7 that were filmed immediately after it. Between the two series, Clarkson went from appearing in 2/3 of the films to barely over 40%, with Hammond and May's roles within the show growing significantly. As a result, it is Series 7 where you can argue that Top Gear started to truly be about the three idiots as a whole, rather than one big idiot and his two friends. Premiering in November 2005, Series 7 got off to a dream start, with the Isle of Man shootout, life-sized RC cars, and an epic race between an Audi RS4 and a pair of mountain climbers. In a year that had the 7/7 bombings, it's hard to describe a day that would devastate a country on anywhere near the same level, but I feel that the 25th of November 2005 came close. On that day, Great Britain lost two of its greatest sports stars, footballer George Best, best known for his role in the 1966 World Cup squad, and 2001 World Rally Champion and personal hero of mine, Richard Burns. Burns was a beloved figure in and around Top Gear, having first taken Clarkson for a ride in his Mitsubishi for Motorworld in the 1990s. He'd also made a few appearances in Top Gear up to that point, and had an off-screen relationship with Clarkson's family, often playing Sega Rally with Clarkson's son, Finlow. Just 2 days after Best and Burns' death, the third episode of Series 7 would air. In it, the trio of Clarkson, Hammond and May would each take three high-powered supercars, the Ford GT, the Pagani Zonda and the Ferrari F430 Spider, out for a road trip across the south of France to the Millau Viaduct. Along the way, Clarkson and Hammond would play a game of table football whilst arguing whether or not the latter had had his teeth whitened. The trio would get caught in the middle of Paris's chaotic traffic around the Arc de Triomphe. Hammond's Pagani would get hung up by the low floor of a car park, and Clarkson would stop an awful lot to fill up his petrol-hungry Ford. The episode was an immediate hit, with 4.6 million people tuning in, making it one of the most viewed episodes of Top Gear up to that point. I should also mention that this was the episode where it was officially disclosed that the programme had won an Emmy, apparently unbeknownst to the BBC, who had turned out in droves for comedy series The Office. Furthermore, according to Google Trends, Top Gear reached its peak internet popularity in November 2005, though an exact reason cannot be determined. Regardless, Series 7 would continue to pack a punch, with the episode the week after that featuring what many consider to be the greatest cheap car challenge of them all, Italian supercars for under £10,000. Inspired by a cover story from a 1997 issue of Top Gear magazine, the three men set out to buy a car that fit this criteria. Jeremy would buy a Maserati Merak, James would buy a Lamborghini Uraco that spent half the challenge on the back of a lorry due to constant electrical problems, and Richard would buy a Dino 308 GT4. Hijinks would ensue, and after both Clarkson and Hammond retired from the final challenge, the former spectacularly detonating his engine, May would conk out just miles from the finish line and cause a newsworthy traffic jam. The week after that, Top Gear arguably raised the bar even further, with their biggest, grandest intercontinental race yet. Jeremy Clarkson, driving a Bugatti Veyron, would go up against Richard Hammond and James May, flying in a privately owned Cessna, with Clarkson eventually winning. Despite a rather tepid final episode, which still managed to leave its mark on the show's legacy, Series 7 wasn't quite out of the tricks just yet. The following February, the first ever Top Gear special would air, centred around the Winter Olympics, which were held that year in Turin. Despite being such a marked departure from the main series, the special would be showered in praise and become Top Gear's second most watched episode up to that point. It's clear that the concept behind the Winter Olympics special had a ring to it, and they would spend the following year extensively fleshing the formula out. In part 2, we'll see how Top Gear moved upwards and onwards from its promising first 3 years on the air, embracing new concepts and evolving the style of the show to one that's more familiar to its younger viewers. But for now, it's time to end. Good night.